Welcome to @Cronkite News, your social sharing connection where you choose the news. Facebook likes and shares, tweets, retweets, and favorites. YouTube views and subscriptions. We're watching you watch us. From our digital home at cronkitenews.azpbs.org to your television, web browser, or mobile device, let's get a refresh on the top Arizona news of the week.
Some science students inspired by the tragedy of Arizona's Yarnell Fire went to the White House Science Fair with a message of hope. Cronkite News reporter Samantha Witherwax has details on the new technology to save firefighters' lives.
It's almost 3 years later and thousands of miles away, but the impact of the Yarnell Fire that killed 19 Arizona firefighters is still being felt throughout the country. The incident drove four high school students to develop a product aimed to save the lives of our firefighters.
Our firefighters are risking their lives every single day when they could be, you know, better protected.
Savannah Kofer was hiking with her family in Arizona in 2013 when she saw smoke from wildfires. A short time later, she found out that 19 Arizona firefighters were surrounded and killed during a fire.
When I saw it at first, I was just shocked at first because I didn't know what exactly was happening, but it opened my eyes to see that there was an unmet need and something that could be valid for further investigation.
So she and three other students who met at a science fair investigated and discovered. The new fire armor technology uses an ice pack-like insulation that was inspired by Savannah's years of soccer.
So in the same way that the instant ice pack, the chemical reaction causes the ice pack to get cooled, the aluminum silica hydrate fiber absorbs the heat from the environment.
And the difference?
Our fibers can provide up to 5 minutes of protection in a flash fire condition, which is really critical considering that the current fibers only last about 5 seconds.
After countless hours, the invention was a success, and now the students have applied for a patent. That success also brought the group to Washington for the White House Science Fair.
We are counting on all of you to help build a brighter future and for you to use your talents to help your communities and your country and the world. We will be with you every step of the way.
Reporting from Washington, Samantha Witherwax, Cronkite News.
In January, Arizona became the first state to require high school students to take the civics test. Cronkite News reporter Alexis Dominguez gives us a look into how a Valley teen is helping students pass.
Riley Danler designed the Arizona High School Citizen app.
I actually had zero experience with building an app, but I had some experience with programming from a class in high school.
The 16-year-old began developing the app by designing the questions.
The questions are from the actual citizenship test, and I edited them to make them like multiple choice questions because most of them were you actually had to write down a full answer, so I developed some answers.
The game is fun and interactive, and you can even make it competitive, playing against friends or even strangers. The game features 8 sections where you can learn about the 1800s and geography.
According to Law for Kids, high schools all over the state are now using this app.
I'm feeling great, honestly. We worked very hard on it. And I'm glad that it's actually helping people.
Now, McDonald's is supporting the project. High school students who complete each section of the app can earn a free Egg McMuffin.
Now that like McDonald's is going through and promoting the app, it's definitely gonna get to more students and it's gonna help them pass.
And he thinks that will get students to download and play.
Oh yeah, everybody wants free food.
Riley wants to build on his success with the citizenship app, and he plans to go to college to become a programmer. The app is available on the Apple App Store, and Riley hopes to make the app available to other devices in the near future. In the broadcast center, Alexis Dominguez, Cronkite News.
Congress has gone to the dogs, at least the fourth floor of the Cannon Building.
Cronkite News reporter Katie Bieri has a story from Washington that just might give you pause.
For the most part, Congressman David Schweikert's staff is pretty accommodating.
But a couple staffers especially won't give you the back of the hand.
Or should I say paw?
Oh, she's strong. We actually have an office tradition. Babies and canines are always invited. We haven't convinced anyone to bring their cat yet. Yes, and the chaos continues.
It's a policy appreciated by all his staffers.
Just the peace of mind that he's not home alone, destroying my apartment.
I don't think I've ever left her at home.
And yes, Congress might have a pack mentality, but Schweiker welcomes dogs from both sides of the aisle.
I know my dog at home is a Democrat because he expects me to clean up after him. He expects me to feed him.
And visitors leave the office with a tale to tell.
It was kind of a nice surge of happiness to be able to come in and actually see an animal in the office, a congressman's office.
It was just a nice kind of welcoming environment. It makes you feel more comfortable coming in.
So besides some minor work annoyances,
we have probably 20 of these around the office. Something and
an MI or something. It's all worth it.
Was it Harry Truman who said, if you want a friend in Washington, D.C., get a dog? So we have two. We at least have two friends.
Dixie.
In Washington, Katie Beery, Cronkite News.
When wife to presidential hopeful Bernie Sanders visited Tent City, she expected just to view it from behind the gates. But Sheriff Joe Arpaio had a different plan.
Reporter Julia Thatcher sat down with the controversial lawman to discuss the backlash he's received from bringing her inside.
It was very interesting. That day, when asked if she wanted a tour of Tent City, she said yes and seemed to have no reservations about it. But later, her husband, Bernie Sanders, expressed his displeasure, accusing the sheriff of, quote, crashing her meeting.
Whether you support it or not, most in America have heard of Tent City. Jane Sanders visited the compound and used the backdrop to bring light to her concerns on immigration.
What we have to have is a comprehensive immigration reform with a path towards citizenship, and we need to do that yesterday.
When she went to see Tent City, she didn't expect to go inside.
Had I known he was here, I probably would have asked to meet him.
But Sheriff Joe Arpaio wanted to take her in and show her what it's all about, so he did.
She talked to all the inmates, got their side of the story. She's complaining about 130 degrees. Like I told her, our men and women are fighting for our country, living in tents. I'm not concerned about convicted criminals living in a tent.
And that's when the controversial sheriff found himself a mudslinging target of a presidential candidate, but probably not the one you'd expect.
The fact that he crashed her meeting is, to me, very, very wrong. Not something that he should have done.
Arizona, Sheriff Arpaio, and Tent City are often stops on the campaign trail, but looking back, the sheriff told me this one was different than most.
And it said, the people I treat don't have the power to speak out. And then he says, if I'm the president of the United States, I will have the power. And then the veiled threat, watch out, Joe. So what is he doing? Threatening me?
Little, if anything, seemed threatening during Jane Sanders' visit, who had the chance to speak with inmates to get their take on the controversial jail.
I mean, it's all right. It's cool that they got the phones on most of the time, so you can call whenever. You get to work, so the time goes a little bit faster, you know?
While some clearly disagree with the living conditions inmates endure while in the facility, the sheriff says he has no plan to change what he says has worked for the past 22 years.
While there, Sheriff Arpaio encouraged Jane Sanders to walk around and talk to anyone she wanted. He said he had nothing to hide. In Phoenix, Julia Thatcher, Cronkite News.
Another divisive day in Washington as the battle over the Obama administration's policies on deferred deportation hit the U.S. Supreme Court. Arizona is one of 26 states included in the case that could affect millions of undocumented immigrants. Cronkite News reporter Lauren Clark found out how this case affects the lives of those protesting.
For the thousands of protesters that showed up today at the Supreme Court, this is much more than just a lawsuit. It could determine if they'd be able to stay with their families or continue their lives here in the U.S.
And they get deported. Who stays behind? Their children stay behind.
Thousands gathered outside the Supreme Court while the justices heard oral arguments for one of the most important cases this year, the U.S. versus Texas. The ruling would dramatically affect the life of one Arizona resident, Claudia.
I am undocumented myself. I'm
fighting for myself, for my husband, for my brother, for my mom.
Parents like Claudia could avoid deportation and stay with their children born here in the U.S. under a policy proposed by the Obama administration in 2012. But Texas, along with 25 other states, including Arizona, argue it's an unlawful and unconstitutional move.
It's not the way things work under the U.S. Constitution. It's not the way things work in our democratic republic.
But for others, it's the chance to live without worrying if a family member will be sent away.
It just tarnishes the family apart. Like, you don't know when you're going to see them again.
This case could also affect
up to 150,000 people in Arizona that would be benefited by the order.
But the impact of this case is far greater, say opponents, than just this program, arguing that these actions is a recipe for disaster.
That is the nature of our government. It always changes. The reason we have a constitutional system is to protect you.
Still, advocates are undeterred. It's not tomorrow they are worried about, but the impending threats of today.
Our communities have a voice, and our voice is going to be heard.
Now, we most likely will not be hearing a decision until June. However, with the possibility of a split 4-4 vote, this could be just another battle in an ongoing war. Live in Washington, Lauren Clark, Cronkite News.
Families here in Arizona directly impacted by the case gathered at the state capitol for a prayer vigil and a rally.
And they spoke to Cronkite News reporter Mauricio Casillas about what's at stake.
Dozens of those affected by the Obama administration's deferred deportation programs took to the capitol today to share their stories. For many undocumented, the Supreme Court's decision could offer a chance to allow them to come out of the shadows.
The Supreme Court's decision on DACA and DAPA affects more than 137,000 people in Arizona directly. Their future in this country all rests on this case. Dozens of immigrants gathered outside the state capitol are on edge as oral arguments for the case began.
Today is very important. I'm feeling a mix of emotions right now. I'm excited, but I'm also panicked.
Promise Arizona, an immigration rights group, organized this rally, which included an 18-hour prayer vigil.
I have a lot of faith that the Virgin Mary is looking out for us at this moment.
While the United States Supreme Court deliberates the fate of DACA and DAPA, families across the country, particularly here in Arizona, are having their own discussion about what the future holds for them and their families.
We've talked to the kids about the possibility of having to move back to Mexico, but they don't want to go because they've never been there. They don't know what it's like.
Several Dreamers are afraid they will have to drop out of school if DACA is repealed.
I'm proud to be a Dreamer, and I'm proud to be a contributing member of this society, especially because 10 years ago, when I moved to the States from South Korea, I could not fathom being a law student.
While the case is now moving forward, they and millions of other immigrants won't have a decision from the Supreme Court until this summer.
We need to come out of the shadows, and they need to take our rights into consideration. They don't do that right now because we don't have papers.
Promise Arizona is organizing another prayer vigil for immigrant families at the Capitol this evening at 7 p.m. Mauricio Casillas, Cronkite News.
Governor Doug Ducey is proclaiming April as Child Abuse Prevention Month. The Arizona Child Abuse Hotline received more than 135,000 calls just last year. Cronkite News reporter Sydney Schofield learned more about one Arizona program that is looking to give a voice to those children.
It gives children in foster care a chance to have a bright future.
20 new court-appointed special advocates, or CASAs, were sworn in this weekend. These volunteers act as advocates for children in foster care.
Their case manager could change, their GAL could change, their social worker could change, but you're the only adult that stays with them throughout the whole process.
Providing some consistency in their lives, CASAs spend time with them each month and write reports that go directly to a judge.
CASAs are the eyes and the ears of the judge. They don't have a horse per se in the race.
As they have a more objective voice, CASAs are able to advocate solely for the child, ignoring other interests that are sometimes involved in child abuse cases.
We work tirelessly to help them find that forever safe home that they're entitled to, where they can thrive and break the cycle of abuse.
There are around 1,000 CASAs in Arizona, but with more than 18,000 of Arizona's kids in foster care, the program is actively looking for more volunteers.
There's so much need out there, and there's so many children that are without a true voice for their own needs and their own circumstance.
It's a wonderful way to make a difference, to invest in the future, because children are our most important natural resource.
And these new CASAs are ready to take on that challenge. In Phoenix, Sydney Schofield, Cronkite News.
A school shooting, a gang arrest, and hostage situations are all scenarios our reporter Julia Thatcher endured during virtual reality police training. And now an effort is underway to make sure all officers in Arizona do the same.
Okay, what do you mean?
I know an Oracle. Well, Gabriel Goodford was.
I was going as fast as I could. It's a few miles. Couldn't tell you exactly how many miles, but it seemed like forever.
Ryan Inglett says he was prepared to arrive on scene January 8th, 2011, in part because he had gone through virtual reality training.
This isn't just training for shoot or don't shoot. This is training for all uses of force to include no use of force.
Now, an effort is underway at the state legislature to fund virtual reality training for all officers in Arizona.
Let her go. Do it now. Let her go.
Tempe-based Virtra created more than 100 virtual scenarios for people like police officers or members of the military hoping to create a high-stress environment similar to what they'll face in the field.
Officers need to be held at a higher standard. We expect that, but we also need to provide them the tools to hold them at those higher standards.
During a simulation, if an officer is shot, it triggers an electronic impulse device. For me, they put it on a civilian level, but for an officer, it can be crippling. It teaches them how to work through the pain. And with the number of controversial police shootings on the rise, some argue the time for funding is now.
During the course of the year, they get very little training. And keeping up those skills and new technologies are very, very helpful. So that's why I think it's now.
When I went through the virtual reality training, they tried to make it as real for me as it is for the officers, even taking the time to break down my split-second decision-making to give me a better understanding of having to justify my actions.
How would you like it if a police officer showed up and didn't even know anything about you?
Okay.
And started just pointing a taser straight at you? That would be kind of weird.
Even in those virtual reality situations, you still elevate. You know, your adrenaline still gets going.
Providing training statewide comes at a price, up to $6 million. But at the end of the day, supporters say it's worth it to protect the public and those who serve it.
I get up and I do the job that I love, and that's what most cops do.
In Phoenix, Julia Thatcher, Cronkite News.
Since 2001, more than 100,000 immigrants have become citizens after serving in the military. But it's not automatic, and some veterans have been deported. Cronkite News reporter Clara Benitez traveled to a shelter in Tijuana that's helping veterans stuck in Mexico.
All veterans who run into problems with the law face consequences, but those who are not citizens can also be deported. I talked to some of those veterans at the shelter in Tijuana.
Off a busy street in Tijuana, Mexico, hangs a U.S. flag on a door. This veteran support house, called the Bunker, is where men who served in the military go for help after they're deported.
United States, and now you're thrown into a country you really don't know.
That is what happened to Hector Barajas after he was charged with an aggravated felony.
So I did plead guilty in 2002 to a discharge of a firearm into a vehicle, which is PC code 246 in the state of California. In 2004, I was deported for that.
Barajas had served in the Army as part of the 2nd Airborne Division. He, like many immigrants, thought by enlisting, he'd automatically become a U.S. citizen.
Soldier thinks, well, I raised my hand to the ultimate enlistment, which is similar to the naturalization, I'm a citizen. My recruiter told me I'm a citizen, and that's it. You know, you believe everything Uncle Sam tells you and your recruiters and your chain of command.
Barajas set up this shelter to help other deported veterans, like Jesus Antonio Juarez Castillo, who was deported in 2003. Castillo enlisted when he was just 17.
Like a family here, you know, something that I didn't have before. You know, we're real close, all of us, you know. We stay together and try to help each other.
Providing food, shelter, and support, the Bunker has been a blessing for many veterans. Many signed their name on the wall as a symbol of thanks for Barajas.
Not only does the Bunker offer in-house resources, for example, staying here, but also offers resources to other deported veterans in different countries.
So we got a guy in India that we currently connected with the ACLU. They're working on a U visa form. There's another guy in Ecuador.
Deported veterans are not able to get VA benefits, and many suffer from PTSD.
The only way I'm going home is in a bag, in a coffin. So I think if we're going to be allowed to return as American veterans, we should be allowed to live with our American families for the rest of our lives.
Barajas is fighting for deported veteran rights so that one day all veterans can live in the country they fought to defend.
Veterans Day, 4th of July, and you can't say, I'm a veteran also. This is my country.
The Department of Homeland Security now has a program to ensure immigrants who enlist also apply for citizenship and complete the process by the end of basic training. In the broadcast center, Clara Benitez, Cronkite News.
The time is to file taxes has come and gone, and now the IRS is expected to process over 150 million returns this year. But while the number of returns is up, there are concerns that they will only find a fraction of potential tax fraud cases. Cronkite News reporter Samantha Witherwax is in our Washington Bureau with the details.
In Arizona, the number of criminal prosecutions for tax fraud fell from 69 in 2010 to 19 last year, according to TRAC, which is a database of federal records kept by Syracuse University. Nationally, the number of referrals fell 30% in the last 2 years, TRAC said, to the lowest level during the Obama administration. Now, the IRS does not dispute the numbers, telling us in a statement today that steep budget declines have left it unable to hire the agents it needs. One tax watchdog said the drop was to be expected.
It's not surprising that if you reduce the funding to the IRS, you reduce the funding for enforcement, then you're going to get reduced numbers of enforcement actions.
But Pete Sepp with the National Taxpayers Union said that doesn't mean IRS officials are sleeping on the job. Referrals may be down, but Sepp thinks that the IRS is finding other ways to catch cheaters.
The agency is still placing an emphasis on enforcing the tax laws, maybe through other means than actually hauling people into court for criminal charges.
In the last 10 years, within the IRS, administration and bureaucracy funding increased over 150%, while taxpayer service decreased over 40%. But the area where SEP believes new action is being taken is in the enforcement funding, which has gone up 14%.
It's very easy to say, oh, fewer criminals are being prosecuted in court for tax reasons. The system must be falling apart. That's too simplistic of an answer. It's important to examine other enforcement and examination activities.
But the IRS says the math is simple. The less agents they have, the less cases that can be worked on, and the fewer criminals that are going to be brought to justice. They also said that they can expect to see this trend continue on this year. Reporting from the nation's capital, Samantha Witherwax, Cronkite News.
The true measure of all our actions is how long the good in them lasts.
This is who I am, where I'm from.
If you're on the right side of history, you can accomplish anything.
It's a connection between your present and your past.
Come this way. This is good. This is very good.
We are attempting to fulfill the promise of America.
The stories about who we are shape us.
This chance to go through a time machine.
Good heavenly day.
We should know our history.
It informs, but it doesn't constrict you.
It's a framework to carry out human activity. Look around,
the sky is the limit.
It started a long time ago.
Now, here's an at Cronkite News pick of the week, a favorite from the Cronkite News staff.
For many African American men, the barbershop is a second home, and the barbers are viewed as wisdom bearers and leaders. Now, they're leveraging their role to become community health advocates.
Hey, we got a grown man pop corner.
Anthony Gathers opened AG's Hair Center in 1996 simply because he liked to cut hair. Now, 20 years later, with two locations, he fully understands what the barbershop means to his community.
This is, more a greeting place and a meeting place for young men, older men, kids and everything else.
Here in these chairs at AG's, regular customers chat with their barbers about everything from sports to politics. And that creates a place for them to also discuss things like personal health.
The American Heart Association approached Gathers a few years ago with a simple idea, installing blood pressure monitors at the shop for customers to use.
Black men don't like to go to the doctor at all. We're all right, you know, we're tough, we're rough, you know, and some of us don't have the insurance to go, and if we do, we feel that we're invincible sometimes.
Olga Davis has examined healthcare issues for years and is convinced the barbershop is a place where change can happen.
It's a space for men to come and to engage one another and to talk to one another, have discourse in ways that they usually don't in any other space.
And others are becoming interested in the Arizona experiment.
Individuals calling us, calling the barbershops from Detroit, from Columbus, Ohio, I think as far as Florida.
In Phoenix, Gathers has seen it inspire individual change.
Some people go and put the cuff on themselves and they want to know where they're at. Or if somebody doesn't know, they say, sure, take my blood pressure, and then we educate them.
One side note, the American Heart Association says nearly half of African-American women suffer from cardiovascular disease. So Davis hopes to expand this program into beauty salons. Blake Bernard, Cronkite News.
Cronkite News tracks your likes, tweets, and shares from all our social sites to bring you this news special. At Cronkite News, our weekly refresh. Join the conversation so you choose the news. Like us on Facebook, follow us on Twitter, subscribe to us on YouTube, and log on to cronkitenews.azpbs.org for top Arizona stories anytime.
Arizona PBS, a viewer-supported community service of Arizona State University.